in 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter, 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. Thank you, Lord. Miracle month.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Miracle month. Amen. I like that. And I heard the man of God say, see, I just talk a little bit talk. Because between the apostle and senior pastor, they just stepped all in my Kool-Aid. And all I got to do is just take my little stir and just stir it up a little bit, all right? Hallelujah. They made my assignment real easy this morning. But the Bible declares, by the mouth of two or three shall his word be established. Listen, beloved, we don't have the luxury of taking the word lightly. For this word is our life. In it, we ought to live. Notice what I say. In it, we ought to live, move, and have our being. Not just on Sunday morning.
That's right.
Or whatever the designated midweek assembly might be. But this ought to be our lifestyle. And this is why, as I listen to the woman of God, the church is in the condition and state that it's in now. Because we want to be part-time believers.
Amen.
Part-time Christians.
Amen.
Part-time lovers.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
But my word says he's a jealous God.
Yes.
And he said, I will have no other before me.
Yes.
I've got to be first in your life.
Yes.
I've got to be first in the midst of your experience. And what I love about him, he gave us this in Matthew 6 and 33 that says, if we keep him first, seek him first, then all these things shall be added unto you. I don't understand why church folks run around looking for a blessing. I'm glad he helped me grow up and understand I don't have to look for a blessing. But if I abide in him and allow his word to abide in me, not only do I have the right to ask what I will, but the blessings will find me. And not only find me, but they will overtake me. Why? Because I've made up my mind I'm going to keep him first.
Amen.
Hence, this is the challenge for us as believers.
Yes.
Because I heard it already said, there are distractions, voices that seek to get our attention away from God's promise, God's plan, and God's purpose for our lives. Here now we look at 1 Samuel, verse 29. David says, what have I done? Is there not a cause? And he turned from him towards another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. And when the words were heard which David spoke, they rehearsed them before Saul. And he sent for him. Verse 32 says, and David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. Thus ends the reading of the Holy Writ. And may we cherish it within our hearts and continue to walk therein. Just for conversation this morning, I want us to focus on verse 32 that says, and David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. I heard the apostle decree into the atmosphere that there is a shift. And it's important that in this season we be sensitive to the moving of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
See, it's easy to get comfortable, content, and complacent in what God did instead of continuing to pursue Him for what He is doing. And if you don't think it happens, let's look in the Bible.
Yes.
On the Mount of Transfiguration, the story tells us that Peter, John, and James were with Jesus.
Yes.
And received a visitation where God again spoke across time and confirmed that this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And He said, hear ye Him. Peter and John, after Jesus got up off the ground, said, Lord, it's good that we were here. Can we build a memorial? See, they got stuck or were about to get stuck in what God was doing on the Mount of Transfiguration. But the Lord had to challenge them and remind them that the work isn't here, but the work is in the valley. And you've got to descend. Hold your peace. Let no man know what you experience, but remember, for there's coming a season, a time, and a shifting when you will declare the wonders and the glory of God. I'm built for it. I'm built for it. If we are facing some dark and troublesome days in front of us, and instead of the church coming out of the closet, the church is going in the closet. And everything that's contrary to the glory of God is manifesting itself in our families, on our jobs, in our community. But God sent me by this morning to tell somebody that you've been positioned for greatness. You've been positioned for greatness. See, it's not just coincidence that you are in this season, but God ordained this season for your life. He positioned you where you are that He might manifest His glory in you, with you, and through you. And if you don't believe that, let's look at the text. The Bible says, y'all know David's story. He had been anointed to be king over Israel. But just because you get a promise don't mean it's time for the promise to manifest. But when you get a promise, you've got to prepare for the promise. Oh, look at it, hit me this morning. David got anointed, and upon his coronation, he went right back to the dusty field on the backside of the desert, tending to the most stubborn and rebellious sheep. He stayed faithful to the assignment that was at his hand. You don't worry about you are usher today, but baby, you're set up to be a king tomorrow. Don't worry about being servant to the man and woman of God, because it's through them your blessing will eventually manifest. But the Bible says, faithful is He that calleth you, who will also do it. Not you do it.
Come on!
But He'll do it. So what David did after receiving his coronation was went back to the dusty side of the mountain and stayed faithful. Look at your neighbor and say, be faithful. Don't get weary in well doing. For in due season, baby, you're going to reap if you faint not. The Bible says that while David was being faithful, that Jesse, his father, sent for him. See, there comes an appointed time. The Bible says, y'all know Ecclesiastes 3:1, that to every purpose there is a season and a time under the heavens. Come on, somebody. David was faithful, and his father, Jesse, sent for him. Can I tell somebody this morning? God is calling you. Just like Jesse called David, God is calling somebody here this morning for such a time as this. And all God wants you to do is just come. And when David came to his father, he didn't know why his father was calling him, but he responded to the call. Did you hear what I just said? He didn't know why he was calling him, but he responded to the call. And see, he's going to give it to us here a little, there a little, line upon line, precept upon precept, according to our faithfulness.
Yes. Yes.
See, the level of your consecration is your level of authorization. See, because he continued to consecrate himself and set himself apart, Jesse called him and said, now, I don't need you to be a shepherd, but I need you to be a courier. I need you to take this cheese. I need you to take this pottage up to the front line where your brothers who are warriors are fighting against our enemy. And then I want you to come back and give me a report. And as David walked in obedience, see, I heard the prophet say when it came to giving the offering, you can't do it your way. You got to do it according to the way that God gave instructions in order to reap the benefit that God has assigned to the instructions. Look at what I just said. Come on, somebody. He said, go check it out and come back. But what David didn't realize, because of his submissiveness and obedience, God was setting him up to show him off. He didn't know that this was his appointed season, but he simply purposed in his heart that he was going to be faithful to the instructions that God had given his father, Jesse, had given him. And when he got close to the front line, he began to hear a sound that didn't displease his enemy. He began to hear a sound of his enemy taunting the saints of the living God. And instead of the saints of the living God taking courage, and after they've done all to stand therefore, they were like a leaf in a strong Chicago wind, hiding behind trees, hiding behind stones, in fear of opportunity. From the king to the mighty men of valor, they were hiding from opportunity. But here comes a young lad who hears the challenge. Oh, can you hear the challenge of God? Can you hear this morning deep calling unto deep? David heard, and as he heard, he began to inquire, what is this? What is this? And suddenly somebody stepped up with a news flash. Extra, extra, read all about it. The king is looking for a hero. He's tired of working with zeros. And now he's looking for a hero. And the king has set a decree that if a hero will step up to the plate, that not only will he bless him on his going out and bless him on his coming in, but he'll be entitled to the king's best gift, which was the king's daughter. When David heard the decree, David said, I was built for this. I was built for this. And about that time, his elder brother heard David testify. See, I'm glad we overcome by the word of our testimony. But can I remind somebody this morning that you better mind what you're saying, because somebody's listening to the word that will decree into the atmosphere, and everybody's not going to agree with your story. Hallelujah. His brother heard him say, I was built for such a time as this, and envy and jealousy, hate of Kool-Aid began to flow, and his brother stepped up and said, who do you think you are? You're nothing but a keeper of a few sheep. You better recognize me and your two brothers are mighty men of valor. And yet they were hiding behind a tree stump. But David didn't let what somebody else saw hide. Somebody else saw him. The tree into him who he was. Can I tell somebody, don't let your experience define you. Don't let the words of family define you. Don't let the words of friends define you. Don't let the words of enemies define you. But let the word of the living God define who you are. In whose report, beloved, are you going to believe? David said, I'm going to believe God and recognize that I was built for for this.
Amen.
David took off the armor of Saul and picked up that was proven. And he didn't stay where he was, but he repositioned himself. Tell your neighbor, reposition yourself. He didn't stay where he was, but he repositioned himself. He didn't stay with the camp, but he got outside the camp. Sometimes you got to leave those that you thought was standing with you, and you got to stand with the God who proved himself through thick and thin. And the Bible says David ran to confront his giant. God is looking for somebody on this glorious Sunday morning who's ready to stand and confront their enemy.
Prosperity.